Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, so our announcements are on the back, pensvalleyparish.info. January 14th is the potluck lunch and the Ag Council meeting after. January 15th, Trinity Trustees and Ad Board meeting at 7 p.m. All are welcome. And January 17th is Wednesday Bible study, 10 to 11:30 at St. James in Coburn. Bring your Bible. We will supply one if needed. If you benefit from taking notes, bring along what you need. This is a casual study open to everyone. And January 17th is the organizational meeting of the Charge Staff Parish Relations Committee, 7 p.m. at St. James. Ladies' Coffee and Conversation at St. James in Coburn at 9:30 on January 18th. And January 31st is the Soup Kitchen at St. James. And I'll leave off on February. Are there any other announcements?
I don't think so.
Okay. Then our centering words, as we focus on the light of the world, God's vision of justice and love grows clearer and shines more brightly in our thoughts and actions. And accolade. Either in body or spirit, if you could rise and call to worship. The Magi waited and watched, knowing something wondrous would be happening.
We waited for the birth of Jesus. Now something wondrous is about to take root.
The darkness that invaded all lives was banished by the light of that star.
The darkness, what surrounds us, is gone.
Let us celebrate the bright shining of God's love in our lives.
Let us become those who will bring the light of God's love to others.
And then our opening prayer.
God of promise and mysterious light, be with us this day as we journey in our faith to meet your gift. Give us courage and hope along our way, as your light will continue to glow brightly in our path, leading us to service and discipleship in Jesus' name. Amen.
And our opening hymn is the First Noel, number 245.
We have seen the light of the world. We've been called to follow the star of promise, and like the Magi before us, we bring our gifts in order to honor the Christ child. So let us bring God's light to all the dark places in our community and in our world. Through these gifts, God will multiply, and we'll first prepare to bless those gifts by singing together the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. God of hope and joy, the gifts that we offer to you pale when our minds try to grasp all you have given to us. You've given us wholeness in our woundedness and hope in our despair and peace in our turmoil, forgiveness in our rebellion. Like Simeon, our eyes have seen your salvation and you give us light in our dark. So help us embrace your extravagant generosity as we give ourselves to others. It's in the Savior's holy name that we pray, and all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. Could I have picked a higher pitch to start that on? Aren't you glad we have a piano player? We do pray for all of those who are experiencing war for whatever reason, and we pray for those who are oppressed and those who are experiencing hardships, and we certainly celebrate all of the things that have happened in the past week. I know that there have been a couple of people who've gotten engaged, and there have been a few who have had birthdays, and so we celebrate all the celebrations as well. So we're going to go to God, and we're going to share with God those things that we hold in confidence that we don't feel comfortable sharing out loud. So we will go to God in silent prayer first, and then we will all pray together. Patient Lord, we ask that you would wait for us a little while longer as we still feel a little nostalgic over the manger scene. Our hearts are still warmed by the witness of the shepherds and the journey and the adoration of the Magi. We want to stay right at that time and feel the glow of all of that love, the experience and excitement of the shepherds. But you call us to leave the manger. You call us to go back to our fields. That means back to our schools and back to our homes, back to our work, back to our organizations. And you pour your transforming love into our lives, and we are challenged to bring back all those places, to all those places, the good, glad news of hope and salvation. We ask that you would remind us again of all the opportunities that we are given to celebrate your love and your power. And help us find joy serving others, even when some of the others are difficult to serve. As we brought the names of those near and dear to you before the throne of grace, asking for your healing mercies, help us to remember that the love poured out in the light of that natal star is still given for us today. Give us grace and peace to reach out to all of those in need, no matter what the need be. You call us to be people of prayer, so let us now share the words that Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our hymn of preparation, which is number 229. Please remain seated for this one. It is Infant Holy, Infant Lowly.
Infant Holy, Infant Lowly, for his bed a cattle star. knowing, little knowing, Christ the babe is Lord of all. Swift winging, angels singing, Noel's ringing, tidings bringing, Christ the babe is Lord of all. Flocks were sleeping, shepherds keeping vigil till the morning new. Saw the glory, heard the story, tidings of a gospel true. Thus rejoicing, free from sorrow, praises voicing, greet the morrow. Christ the babe was born for you.
At this time, we'll begin our scripture readings. We're going to begin in the book of Isaiah, chapter 60, with verses 1 through 6. This is a glorified Zion. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, darkness will cover the earth, and deep darkness the peoples. But the Lord will rise upon you, and his glory will appear upon you. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. Lift up your eyes round about and see. They all gather together. They come to you. Your sons will come from afar, and your daughters will be carried in the arms. Then you will see and be radiant, and your heart will thrill and rejoice, because the abundance of the sea will be turned to you. The wealth of the nations will come to you. A multitude of camels will cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah. All those from Sheba will come. They will bring gold and frankincense and will bear good news of the praises of the Lord. In our second reading, which is from the book of Matthew, the Magi are certainly Gentiles. They are not Jews. They're journeying to find the newborn king of the Jews because of who the prophet says he is, a savior to all the world. They see Jesus and they find Jesus, but take special notice of what worshiping Jesus makes possible for them. It's something we've seen God do through Israel and his son Joseph, Genesis, and through his earthly father Joseph as well. This is Matthew chapter 2, verse 1 to 12, the visit of the Magi. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, Magi from the east arrived in Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. Gathering together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They said to him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for this is what has been written by the prophet. And you, Bethlehem, land of Judea, are by no means least among the leaders of Judah. For out of you shall come forth a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod secretly called the Magi and determined from them the exact time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. And when you have found him, report to me so that I too may come and worship him." After hearing the king, they went their way. And the star which they had seen in the east went on before them until it came and stood over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. After coming into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell to the ground and worshiped him. Then, opening their treasures, they presented to him gifts of gold,
frankincense, and myrrh. Having been warned by God in a dream not to return to Herod, the Magi left for their own country by another way. In our final reading from the book of Luke, what Simeon and Anna foretold about what Jesus would mean for Israel is recalled as Mary and Joseph and Jesus, now age 12, who is now coming out of the age of innocence and into the age of majority. He's really coming into his own in the temple. He finds his voice as the Son of God. So this is attending to the ordinances of God, means doing the things that your custom calls you to do, the things that God says is important. And that's exactly what they're doing when God breaks in. So here, Luke chapter 2, verses 41 to 52. This is a visit to Jerusalem. Now Jesus' parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. And when he became 12, they went up there according to the custom of the feast. And as they were returning, after spending the full number of days, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. But his parents were unaware of it, but supposed him to be in the caravan and went a day's journey. And they began looking for him among their relatives and acquaintances. When they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem looking for him. Then, after 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the teachers, both listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. When they saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us this way? Behold, your father and I have been anxiously looking for you." And he said to them, "Why is it that you were looking for me? Did you not know that I had to be in my father's house?" But they did not understand the statement which he had made to them. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth, and he continued in subjection to them, and his mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus kept increasing in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Epiphany is, of course, a word we use. We usually use it when we talk about we have a great idea, right? We'll say we had an epiphany. And today we have Epiphany Sunday. Yesterday was the Feast of Epiphany. Merriam-Webster has a couple of things to say about the word epiphany. The first definition is a church festival in commemoration of the coming of the Magi as the first manifestation of Christ to the Gentiles, or in the Eastern Church in commemoration of the baptism of Christ. The second is an appearance or manifestation, especially of a divine being. Now, the first definition we know to be very obvious, it's about the Magi. And the second definition, though, is what we think, I think anyway, we're hearing about as Jesus is age 12 at the temple, believing with all of his heart that he is obeying God the Father by staying in his father's house, having lengthy discussions with the teachers, taking time apart to be in the presence of God. Interesting that it took his parents 3 days to figure out he'd be in the temple. But I think that sometime God's timing is God's timing. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you now to consider turning points that are communicated through your word, and we pray that the words taken to heart are yours, and that the thoughts and meditations of all our hearts are pleasing to you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Now, hearing about Jesus staying behind at the temple without Mary and Joseph's knowledge can hit our ear in a few different ways. We tend to hear it from a parent's standpoint, because usually I think it's one that we can kind of relate to. And not just parents, it's anybody who's babysat, anybody who's had to be responsible for kids. We know the horrible feeling of losing track of one. Like, you know, Johnny's supposed to be here, and we turn, Johnny's not here, and then the panic sets in, and oh, Johnny's over here. So we have this reaction and response when we lose track of a child. It's upsetting. The only thing that matters is locating the child. There is a whole lot of other emotion that comes along with it. But the main thing is the main thing. First, we want to make sure that the child is safe. And then all the other emotions get to come out. So we're first, you know, checking them over. Are you okay? You're okay? You're all right? Okay. But once we get that all taken care of, then it's, what were you thinking? Why did you do that? Why were you, you know where you were supposed to be? So we know that that first emotion is the one that we tend to first. And then we have those others. So we kind of tend to camp in the Mary and Joseph part of that story a little bit longer. But I'm going to challenge us today to go and focus more on Jesus' experience. It says in Luke, after spending the full number of days, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. For how many days? Well, we know that they traveled an entire day. They would have traveled an entire day coming back. And then they spent 3 days looking for him. A lot of days. And he's in the temple the entire time. He didn't forget to go home. And he didn't just fall asleep when they left. He stayed intentionally in the temple, not the least bit concerned about his choice to stay behind, knowing full well that his family's returning home. There's something that made Jesus believe this is the most important thing and this is where I have to be right now. And there was nothing from God indicating he was wrong. He's awakened to something. This time at the temple was different. His purpose is understood and there's no time to waste. And I believe that Jesus is so excited and ready to get started that he's going to stay. He wants to know more. He wants to have this time with these teachers. And let's face it, 5 days, 3 to 5 days, depending on who you are, if you're estimating time, we know at least three. That's a long time to stay behind with these teachers. And what might have occurred during those 5 days? Certainly there was an impression made. But this is God's will for him. So what's the problem? He's in his father's house talking to his father's teachers, and I have no doubt that Jesus has heard about the circumstances of birth. He's probably heard it many times. He has probably heard about all of the visitors from the shepherds to the magi. He has heard about what Simeon and Anna had to say that we talked about last week when he was dedicated at the temple as a baby. So his earthly parents, Mary and Joseph, we know that they understood who Jesus was going to be one day. But they were still seeing Jesus as a 12-year-old boy. Although they acknowledged who Jesus would become long before his birth, this became a pivotal time for them too. For Jesus, this awakening at the temple means he understands now who he is. It's not head knowledge anymore. He's found his voice as the Son of God. It's no longer what someone else is telling him as head knowledge or facts. It's what he understands about himself. It's now pouring out of him. All these things that people have been pouring into him, all the dots have been connected. And Jesus experiences this discernment. Where? At the temple for the feast of the Passover, attending to the ordinances of God. Remember the three rules, the three simple rules of John Wesley? Do no harm, do good, attend to the ordinances of God. And once again, God breaks in extraordinary ways to individuals who are attending to the ordinances of God. There are many people, myself included, who have awakened to an understanding sitting in a church pew. I awakened to the understanding I was called to preach sitting in a church pew. And I've heard many other people talk about having an epiphany while sitting in a church pew. Frederick Buckner said, the place God calls you to, the place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meet. No doubt Jesus finding his voice as the Son of God brought about a deep gladness, and certainly the world's deep hunger would be met there in the temple. And those who are seeking to grow in faith and relationship with God are also seeking that kind of deep gladness in their life to know what it is that their purpose has become. What is it right now in this moment? Because sometimes I cannot know what my purpose is in 10 years, but I can know that my purpose right now in the next 5 minutes is to help somebody standing in front of me. I don't have to be in a church pew to do that, But we do see over and over again, especially in the last few weeks, how attending to the typical ordinary things, God will break in. That's how God can actually reach you. Now, the Jewish tradition marks that a certain age is a stepping stone in your faith, the confirmation process. That usually begins around the age of 12 and 13. And we have that same kind of process in our church today. It's confirming their personal understanding, what they understand about God and understand about Jesus and how our faith works, what it means to them personally. It's confirming for them what it means to them personally. And so by that story, it's a very short story, but by that story, we understand the leaders at that synagogue are amazed by what Jesus already seems to understand. And they're engaged in learning more about what he knows. It's not a get away from me, kid, you bother me, come back when you're 18. All generations are taught together. The church Jesus establishes is to be a space of full inclusion during worship and teaching. Every generation is taught together. How many 12-year-olds or younger benefit like Jesus did from being in the room and worshiping together and not feeling at all out of place having theological discussions with teachers? You know, God's interested in us in every age. There's no such thing as a silly question. And in fact, I think that some of the questions children ask in church are questions that grown-ups have in church. Last week, we talked about how some would hear about the Son of God born in Bethlehem and see nothing more than a baby. It's just a baby. At the temple in this passage, some might see Jesus as nothing more than a 12-year-old tween boy. And if they do, they miss that deeper message about God's interest in us at every age. How the church is called to welcome, teach, and encourage its youth. When we get too caught up in taking Mary's or Joseph's role in the story as the harried and frantic parents searching for their lost boy, we can relate more to them naturally, but we miss the lesson we're invited to learn. We're invited to get out of those shoes for other shoes. No one shoved 12-year-old Jesus aside because he was too young to understand or too young to appreciate what the teachers were talking about. Those teachers engaged Jesus. And Jesus, as an example to us of what a 12-year-old is quite capable of, was fully engaged in the life of his community of faith with excitement and curiosity. I wonder how long it had been since anyone of any age asked those teachers a question, let alone would have discussion with them for days. Approaching them with curiosity and a desire to learn. I would bet that those few days stuck with those teachers, maybe for the rest of their lives. They might have wondered, I wonder what's going to happen with this 12-year-old boy, which years later might have become, boy, he's really developing in his understanding of God, and I'm learning from him. This is a pretty special guy. And later on, I wonder what happened to that Jesus of Nazareth. I wonder if they ever had occasion to say, you know that Jesus from Nazareth you keep hearing about? Well, I remember when he was 12. Mary and Joseph were filled with concern and fear and worry about why Jesus would cause them such heartache. But remember what Simeon said last week about the testing not being limited to those who would not accept Jesus as the Son of God, but that his own family, including his mother, would be challenged, a challenge so difficult, the heart could be pierced. I wonder if she remembered that at the temple, when Jesus responds to her with kind of a disappointment of his own, disappointed in the parents who told him who he was, that she would not know where to find him, that she would go everywhere else for days, before realizing he would be found in his father's house, that he would be in his father's care. And suddenly those emotions that come after knowing her child is all right come in hard. But it's no longer a feeling of failure, that Jesus did not do what was expected of him, that somehow this was a failing of hers. To leave with the family for the return trip home was what was expected of him. Instead, their refreshed appreciation for who Jesus was born to be. Truly, he was not mischievous or disobedient to them so much as coming into his obedience to his Father God. Jesus has confirmed to Mary and Joseph yet again who he is and what he will become. I don't think Mary and Joseph thought of trusting Jesus to know the right thing to do as risky, because he was always obedient. He still was. And as Simeon warned, Jesus' obedience to God is going to cause them confusion and discomfort and fear, but not without rewards of discovery and wonder the divine risks make possible. Mary's and Joseph's tolerance for risk was greater than most. After all, remember, they said yes to God a long time ago. They said yes to some difficult life situations for themselves. And they've been insiders in Jesus' story all along, relying on God and accepting the risk. Leaving the temple days ago were Mary's and Joseph's plan, but God had a different plan for Jesus. And by the age of 12, Jesus has united around him people of various walks of life, from shepherds to kings. And next week, we will hear how whatever Jesus chooses to do in the world, he always chooses to do it in concert with other people, which is why the church he established is not a building, but people. Jesus brings diverse people together and sends them out in ministry to the world together. The growth and transformation stories we heard today remind us that no matter how excited we were about what God has already done or what we see God possibly doing, what's in store, our own spiritual formation requires accepting a certain level of risk while attending to our faith traditions, to come to Jesus and be open to where Christ's Spirit may take us. Let us pray. Lord, you've blessed us with life. We praise you for this blessing. What we've done with our lives has both delighted and perplexed you. We're far too often inclined to be stubborn and arrogant, believing that we are all powerful, that we have no need for you. But there is an emptiness in us, a place where we are raw and hurting. In truth, we're bleeding and bruised. We've tried our own healing methods and they have not worked. We feel as though we are an oarless, sailless boat, drifting in water, unable to gain direction, unable to see the shore. We long for home. We long for hope. And from across these waters, you call us. We come to you in contrition, seeking your healing and forgiving love. And God of mercy and love, you have called us over the waters and through the waters of baptism, you've blessed us. You've cleansed and healed us, adopted us as your beloved children. And so we ask that you would help us to live as children of the light, serving you faithfully all our days. And we will give you the glory. It's in Jesus' name that we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Would you please take out a United Methodist hymnal and turn to page 12 as we prepare for the service of word and table. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Please join me on page 12 under the confession and pardon. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. We continue now under the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right
and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. He is the ultimate example of humbling self in obedience to your will and freely accepted death on a cross. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray the words that Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You may remove the bread from the base of the chalice. The body of Christ given for you. Amen. The blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. Let us pray. O Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you've given yourself to us. We ask that you would bless us as we leave this place, that we will take all of this with us, that you have become part of us and we become part of you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Would you please open the United Methodist hymnal to number 251, Rise in Body or Spirit as You Feel Led, as we sing together, Go Tell It on the Mountain.
tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching, o'er silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens there shone a holy light. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. The shepherds feared and trembled when low above the earth rang out the angel chorus that hailed the Savior's birth. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Down in a lowly manger, the humble Christ was born. And God sent us salvation that blessed Christmas morn. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born.
The light of the star, the light of God, shines before you as you leave this place. So go in peace, go in joy, go in love to meet God's people in the world and tell them with good news of salvation. Amen. Go now and know that God goes with you.